All right. I have a question that I don't think anyone has yet to talk about, which is, I think, a little bit of the 2020 question of the year. We know for narcolepsy, of course, that environmental factors and upper airway flus and infections can be environmental triggers for narcolepsy. I think that we know that pretty well, that that's part of the disease development. And of course, this year with COVID-19, I know Dr. Emmanuel, Mignot, and I have spoken before earlier this year, but it's been a few months. And I'm just curious if there's any more thoughts around COVID and any sort of long-term neurological issues and possible cases of narcolepsy that might come from the flu. I mean, sorry, COVID-19.
I do have few cases to answer your question, Julie. I have been asked for two cases probable of narcolepsy following the COVID, but finally I didn't find any. Two suspicion, but they are not narcoleptic at the end. So for sure, I diagnose less patient new diagnoses than last year. So by chance, for sure, you can have COVID and narcolepsy in 2020, for sure, because we should diagnose roughly 50 new patients a year in my lab with type 1. And but I didn't find something very striking as far as I know. And based on what I know and based on Emmanuel, my friend's staff, I think it is very targeted problem with if the flu is really a big trigger and is very specific epitope with molecular mimicry and so on. So I'm not convinced that the COVID will trigger the same thing. So the most important point will be the trigger with when we will have some vaccine, because vaccine plus infection and flu will exist in few weeks for everybody. So if there's two trigger, with a vaccine with adjuvant and a real infection, a flu infection, that could be a problem when both trigger will be together. But COVID alone, I'm not convinced that it will change the story. And I have zero cases in my lab.
Yeah, I suspect that actually there are less people diagnosed because people are anchoring down what's interesting is the fact that Yves is reporting less cases. I mean, is it because we'll see the season, but is it because people are have less flu? Because we should realize, I mean, at least for me, I haven't had any flu at all this entire season because I was totally anchored down in my banker, you know, home. And for the first time, I was not traveling and so forth. So I had absolutely no cold whatsoever, not even anything. In fact, it was very interesting for me because I realized that a lot of the colds that I saw were psychological, because sometimes I felt a little bit bad and I didn't even have that. So I think every year I probably get 10 different kind of small little cold, and I didn't get any of those. So I wonder, actually, it's very interesting if that is not one of the explanation why there is less cases this year, and because of course people are not showing up because they are just more concerned about coronavirus. So that's, I think it could be very interesting, because maybe we'll see the opposite effect, but I have no clue. I mean, I think we will see. I don't know what the experience of other people. I mean, care is so disrupted right now.
And Emmanuel, Emmanuel, in Stanford, did you diagnose less patients than last year, same as me? Or because we discussed less flu, but less flu trigger less narcolepsy. Who knows about that, really?
I couldn't say that I haven't seen, no, yes. Probably yes. Certainly not an increase, but decrease is harder to tell. I think Giuseppe might be also able to answer this question, because he has a very steady stream of young children with really recent onset.
Yes. Dr. Plazzi did say he had to go because he is on call, so...
Okay. So we'll have an answer to this burning question another time. Yeah. And of course, for Christine, Christiane and David, I don't know. I mean, it's a different hemisphere. You are muted, David.
So we're much like you. You know, people aren't participating in healthcare in the same way. And so you can get a false impression, really, of, you know, selection bias, attendance bias. I certainly haven't seen any cases of narcolepsy that I'd attribute to sort of long COVID or post-COVID. Certainly people with fatigue hasn't gone on for long enough to be convinced it's going to be a permanent feature for them. But, yeah, that's the curious thing for me is how much of the more of the IH phenotype might we see or a, you know, because my suspicion is we might see more of that type of presentation.
Yes, I know even in my own family, my sister had COVID and she is usually a little bit more on the insomnia side than me. And she's been having a lot of fatigue very long term since April. And it's interesting to see her talk about hitting a wall around 2 p.m. and needing to take a nap. And it's just so not her. So it is really interesting to see, you know, and hopefully it doesn't continue. but it has been pretty persistent over time for her since April.
There's clearly some CNS effect because loss of smell is, for example, very striking. Mm-hmm. I mean, I have some also a lot of people that says that even months after they can't smell wine, which is very sad, you know.
Well, let's see. And for people that have narcolepsy, I know, you know, I tend to ask this a lot, but it's a question that we get a lot. You know, how should we feel about getting vaccines as they come out? you know, it's a tough topic, but, you know, I know obviously we already have narcolepsy, but there is just sort of a strange feeling, I guess, personally, to think of doing anything that could possibly make my narcolepsy somehow worse. does anyone want to talk about that?
And but I want other people to talk first, maybe. Depending of what, I mean, I can say, I mean, I think like Eve, I don't think there's a very high likelihood that COVID is producing, you know, the phenotype of narcolepsy. It's possible that it could push people through the head through a non-specific inflammatory mechanism that just adds a little bit more to the process, but I don't think it's going to be as specific as the flu. However, I'm a little more worried about other phenomenon because we are learning about COVID being not just an infection, but also a very strong immune reaction. And in fact, many of the consequences of COVID are an excessive immune response to the virus. And for that reason, in very severe patients, especially in the second phase, you know, like, for example, corticoids have been very beneficial to the survival of patients. So, you know, it's always possible that a vaccine similarly could produce an excessive immune response in some patients that could produce either an autoimmune disease or something like Kawasaki, which has been reported to be associated with coronavirus infection in the past, or, you know, some strange reaction. So I think the more troubling thing is just like for every vaccine, I'm a bit concerned that vaccine have been treated like abortion. You know, you are either completely for it or completely against it, and there's no middle ground. And as a consequence, you know, no reasonable debate has been made on this topic. And I think vaccines are incredibly safe, let me be clear, and they work extremely well, but that doesn't mean that they are 100% safe. I mean, 100% safe is only in your dreams. And, you know, we may have something that occurs one for 10,000 or one for 100,000 people or one for a million. And I think it's an error to just say this side effect may never exist. So we're going to discover what's happening. I mean, I'm sure you know that people are starting to realize this. For example, for dengue, you know, there were some side effects which were kind of expected with the vaccines against dengue, because when you get several times dengue, sometimes you develop a very severe form. So for some people who already had dengue when they were vaccinated, they developed this side effect. It was almost expected and it was very rare. It doesn't mean that the vaccine was bad, and it's almost bad that now nobody wants to do the dengue vaccine, whereas I think overall probably it would save a lot of people. So I think we need a really more robust discussion with the vaccine, but I'm absolutely sure that nobody will make it. We're going to rush it and do the same thing all over. But, you know, this is the story of life in America, you know, and in other countries, actually.
So, Australia. Yeah, well, are vaccines going to come out at different times? I mean, I feel like someone just said, was it Yves? Did you said a few weeks that you said something about a few weeks from now, we'll find out about vaccines? Are different parts of the world going to come out different times?
No, I didn't say vaccine for COVID for sure, because nobody knows. I said that in a few weeks, the vaccine for the seasonal flu will be available. And it could be an issue when you will have some flu symptoms to differentiate if it's related to COVID or to flu infection. So I think we should recommend patients to be vaccinated this year to avoid that the COVID infection will be suspected instead of flu infection. It is to make that clear, it is the vaccine, seasonal vaccine for flu. I have no idea at all about the COVID vaccine.
Okay. All right. Thank you for clarifying. I got a little bit confused. I don't know. So, sometimes I lose track of the news and time. So
as you think, we've just gone through a winter in the Southern Hemisphere. And so we had a very big push for flu vaccination in March and April prior to our COVID sort of pandemic. And so we had incredibly high rates of flu vaccination for Australia, much higher than normal. And then we've had incredibly low rates of influenza in the last 6 months, like unheard of low rates of influenza. And it's really, we've avoided that problem. Is it a flu? Is it a coronavirus infection by having that really high rates of flu vaccination?
I think also it's because people self-isolated. So I think—
Absolutely.
Absolutely. I think both have had this is going to be my conclusion is now I'm going to be a bit more cautious when I travel. I'm going to try to wash my hands. I'm going to try to, maybe I'm going to become an Asian. I'm going to wear a mask all the time. I think Yu-shu, you have done very well in Taiwan against the coronavirus. I think the flu, the COVID vaccine, I'm an optimist. So I think we'll get it probably around the winter. There is definitely some trial ongoing and they seem to be safe, but it's on those very small samples. That's the problem. Is not like 1% of people are going to be sick. The problem is more one person for 10,000, because when you vaccine millions, like happened with narcolepsy, it's almost impossible to really kind of catch these very rare events. And that's the one that's a little bit harder to really guess. But I think still, whatever happens, I'm almost sure that we'll know that it's much more dangerous not to get vaccinated against coronavirus, because the risk of dying from coronavirus is still pretty high versus, you know, not getting vaccinated versus having a risk for the vaccination, because there will be at least thousands of people who have been vaccinated and will know that there will be no risk for one for 1,000 or one for 10,000, you know, before it's kind of for the entire population. So I think it's really a no-brainer to get vaccinated against the coronavirus, even for narcoleptic patients.
Emmanuel, didn't you also say, though, that the adjuvant that was maybe going to be used in one of the vaccines might have been similar to the adjuvant that was used back in the H1N1 flu?
Yes, I think the ASO3 adjuvant was bought by a couple of companies to be used in the context of coronavirus. The reason is that this kind of adjuvant is really a antigen sparing. So it potentiates the effect of the vaccine. So you need less material from the virus to produce the same immune response. Again, I think I made my opinion clear, but of course it's an opinion. It's never 100%. That's a problem with this adjuvant in the past for narcolepsy was it was oil on the fire. I think they kind of dosed that vaccine maybe a bit too strongly so that the immune response to that flu was almost too strong versus what you get normally, even with an infection. And I think that was the reason why you got more cases with this. But I think if it's better dosed And considering that it's a different virus, I don't believe it's a problem. But of course, like everything, I'm always ready to be proven to be wrong. I mean, nobody can predict the future. It's just my best guess. It's an opinion. It's my best guess, but it's never 100%.
Yeah. Well, thank you for sharing your opinions and for, yeah, I think it's just, it's really helpful because it can feel a little bit scary for those of us that aren't scientists and don't quite understand all of this. And so just thank you for continuing to share with this community. I know we have people watching from around the world. I've seen comments from Peru and Brazil and the US. And so I just wanted to ask a little bit about awareness. How do you feel like the awareness is in your different parts of the world? Are patients, we've talked a little bit about some places. I know David talked about Australia, you know, that people are really rallying together. How is that? And we talked about Brazil, of course, as well. But how about in France and Taiwan? How's the patient community? Are people raising awareness? Are getting together and you know, fostering community and support there?
So I may answer right now that there is not enough in France. Unfortunately, the patient association is not enough effective in terms of awareness, in terms of to be granted and to have dedicated persons to take care about that. So there's very nice people already affected with the disease, and it's more easy when you have parents of kids affected with the disease, or bed partner, or brother and sister. But if you are affected with the disease, you need to work to help yourself to fight again the narcoleptic problem, and also to take care about other patient is sometimes too demanding, and really they need some support to go ahead in a better shape and to have more time to deal with patient organization. And right now, I know quite well the presidents, the vice president, and so on of the patient association, and they are patient and they are working and also with the family and sometimes with the young kids to take care. So it's too much. And really we need better help, better support to dedicate some patient like you to the main target, and is not often the case in France. So narcolepsy, I love to say, is really underdiagnosed, unfortunately, and it's more than timely to discuss about it, to delay the diagnosis and to increase the diagnosis. And you are here to do so in US, and it's very nice. And I would love to have you, or a clone of you in France, to do the same job.
Oh, hey, I'm happy to move there anytime. My mom and my brother were all ready. We've been talking about where where we're going to head. And so we talked about the south of France. It's high on our list.
Come on. Welcome.
Well, maybe for a visit sometime first. Dr. Bahia, you have a slide here.
Yes. I took some pictures. The Brazilian Narcolepsy Association has contributed greatly to this awareness. Last year, we held an awareness event in the public park here in Rio de Janeiro, talking about narcolepsy to people who were passing by through a motion, and another event through a motion made by the association and the Chamber of Deputies. A law was created that makes the week of narcolepsy official in the calendar of the state of Rio de Janeiro. So, it's good from September 22 to 29. It is opening space for more public events to spread awareness about the disease. There are some pictures, you know, my patient and I, we through association, we also submitted a request to the public authorities for creation of a reference center for the diagnosis of narcolepsy in the hospital I work in. Since then, I have accompanied her in all the meetings to strengthen the process. In the initial meetings, I was still on maternity leave, so I took my baby with she, and my baby is also supporting narcolepsy too. Recently, we managed to deliver the project to the Secretary of Health and the Secretary General of Government, and they committed themselves to the cause. We are very hopeful in Brazil.
Oh, that's so exciting. Keep us posted on all of that and, you know, whatever we can do on social media to help support. And yes, thank you for all this. It's very, very exciting to see the progress you are making. And oh, yes. And you guys have had a ton of events.
Never before have we spoken about narcolepsy as much as we have this year. There are some events, lives promoted by the Brazilian Association patients with narcolepsy. And, we are talking about a lot of narcolepsy this year. And thank you. You are a great inspiration for us. Thank you a lot, Julie.
I love
Project Sleep.
Oh, this is amazing. It's so cool to see all of your efforts, and it's just such a wonderful feeling of energy and mutual support. So just a huge fan of Brazil these days.
You not only show the light in the end of the tunnel, you've been the light that illuminates the way, and all patients are very grateful for your inspiration, and it strengthens the power of the patients and narcolepsy patients. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. I'm not going to cry. All right. I'm going to cry. Thank you so much. It's really just a joy. It makes my life very, very positive and happy and less sleepy when I get to work on this stuff. So I don't know. Dr. Huang, are you there? I'd love to hear a little bit about Taiwan. Oh, she's working.
Sorry. Yeah, I am going to, I have to go. Yeah. I think I'm very happy to meet everybody here. And it's lucky in Taiwan, there is no COVID-19. And I hope it will be like influenza, the common cold just passed. So if the winter is okay for Taiwan, I think it will be good news for every country in the world. So I don't worry about the vaccine, because I believe everybody got it like the common cold. Yeah. So if we wear the mask every day, like every people I want, it can prevent every virus, and it will become like the common cold. So you see it in Taiwan, every people, we wear masks every day. And so there is good for every people to do it, to prevent the COVID-19. And I hope that next year, if there is no COVID-19, we can be together, have a meeting again, and hope to see everybody very soon. And sorry, I had to have a duty. I had to go.
Yes, thank you so much, Dr. Huang. I think that's such an important message. So maybe we need to get some World Narcolepsy Day masks so we can raise awareness with our masks. It's a very, very important message. So thank you so much for joining us. And Dr. Cunnington, is there anything else you wanted to add about Australia and awareness before we end the broadcast? You're on mute.
I think everyone else has summed it up nicely. And as you say, we've got a great patient group in Australia that's really, you know, batting above their weight. So they're really doing a good job of raising awareness in Australia.
Yes, I'm so thankful. So thank you again to this expert panel for taking the time, whether it was, now it's after midnight in Australia, so it's no longer World Narcolepsy Day there.
Yeah.
In here in California, we're just getting started. And I just want to thank everyone for joining. I saw we had messages from France. We had messages from Spain, Brazil. I'm going to miss all of them. I can't see everyone's messages, but I'm really excited to have this video and to share it. So please, if you're watching, go ahead and press the share button and continue to be raising awareness every year. I mean, every day can be World Narcolepsy Day. but just thanks again for this panel. And I think we will go ahead and wish everyone a wonderful World Narcolepsy Day, no matter where you are. And thanks again for all of your efforts and for being here today.